Welcome to UCSD Guestbook. My name is Ivan Schuller. I'm from the physics department at UCSD. My guest today is Professor Harry Kroto from Sussex University. He's the 1996 Nobel Prize winner for chemistry for the discovery of carbon-60. Professor Kroto, welcome to UCSD.
Well, my pleasure. Good to be here.
Since last time I saw you, many things happened in your life. One of the things, you were knighted by I guess, the Queen of England. I'm wondering what is the proper etiquette to address you? Should we call you Sir Harold or Harold
Sir? Well, I would hope that everybody still calls me Harry. I've not changed, but if you look at the protocol, apparently it is Professor Sir Harold Kroto, which raises a big smile on the faces of my friends. And as I said before, those who don't know me, they're impressed by that.
I would like to ask you if you could describe us very briefly what was this discovery of the Buckminster fullerene. And what is this? What are we really talking about?
Well, it's a fairly unusual discovery at the end of the 20th century because it's so fundamental. If one looks at the elements of the periodic table, many have been known for a long time. Carbon's been known for aeons. I mean, our earliest ancestors knew carbon and graphitic materials, apart from soot and things like this. And diamond, of course, has been found, and that's been known to the ancients. And these are two forms of carbon. They look very different, but they're the same atoms of carbon. And we discovered a third form, which has this beautiful structure, in which the atoms are located on a surface which is rather similar to that of a soccer ball. So if you put an atom at these positions, which you'll find there are 60 in the case of the soccer ball, you get this molecule. And that was a totally unexpected discovery. Which we found by accident.
And can you put it to us within the context of chemistry? Where does this, where does this fit into the context of general chemistry, organic chemistry, inorganic chemistry,
well,
physics?
Yes, it does now. It didn't at the time. I mean, because no one really appreciated that you could make a three-dimensional structure, in fact, an architecture on a microcosmic scale, involving atoms. And up till then it was assumed that graphite was the most stable form and that it would always be flat. But what we found, and I think is the perspective, the change in perspective, is that if you make a graphite sheet, which is all the atoms in a hexagonal pattern, if you look on this case, and graphite is a sheet just of hexagons, if you can see it here, so you can make a sheet of hexagons like that, it will be flat. But if you put pentagonal structures into it, it will form a ball. And that just was not expected to be an easy thing to do. But it turns out that if you just take 60 carbon atoms and say, do what you want, they will form a cage. And that was a big discovery. I mean, I think Osawa, a Japanese, had actually thought of this structure and said if you could make it, it would be stable. What nobody thought of is that it would just form itself. And that was very surprising. And it's changed chemistry from a flat area to an area now that we know is actually three-dimensional and has these cage possibilities.
Is this a nationalistic kind of a thing, or what is the reason for this ball in the...
Well, I mean, it's actually international. I don't like nationalism, I like internationalism, and if anything is international, I think the soccer ball is, and this is the most recent form of it. I mean, this structure is only since the 60s, in which we have these 12 pentagons and the hexagons. In the old days, the soccer ball was rather like a basketball. It had that same structure. But this is the new form, and this is the international football or soccer ball. Not nationalistic, I don't think.
So can you describe for us this discovery? What is the scientific impact of this discovery? Ordinarily, when one talks about scientific discoveries, usually most programs, TV programs, or most discussions in the public press, we talk about scientific impact, and then we talk about some application.
Yes.
And I would like to ask you about the scientific impact, the purely scientific impact.
Well, the pure scientific impact is that this has changed our view of what carbon chemistry, organic chemistry can do. It has added a significant new dimension. We now know that we can make a whole new set of compounds with these cage structures. Let's look at it, for instance. It's actually an extremely rigid structure. It is the heart, it's the toughest molecule that's been made. We can bounce it off surfaces at huge energies before it will break up. We can put atoms on the inside. So
one, I noticed that it's round. Does
yes, not obviously. If you ask, does it roll? It may roll on a single on a surface, but when we get down to molecular dimensions, it's more like the billiard balls that are stacked together. If you put one on top of the other, they actually don't roll easily. It actually does rotate, but rolling is something that's not obviously that's
so
something.
You wouldn't think that it's a good lubricant.
Well, it isn't apparently a good lubricant, mm-hmm. and certainly not by itself. I mean, the one
somehow the first reaction that one has is that it will be a good lubricant.
Yeah, that's what we thought in the paper. We wrote that in our discovery paper. And the first experiment that I did, personally, all of it, all by myself, as soon as I had some pure C60 in 1990, is I took a spatula and squeezed it, and it was nothing like graphite. In fact, graphite is a very odd material. Mm-hmm. In fact, I got a letter recently which said that graphite is not a lubricant on the space shuttle. And that means that we don't understand the graphitic, the lubrication properties of graphite. It's not quite as the textbooks say. But, I mean, it does roll, but it doesn't act as a good lubricant. And I think, because if you think of putting balls on a billiard table, when you put them in the triangle, right, you put the others in the dips between the balls, and they don't actually roll. They hop from one place to the other, and that is a rigidity rather than a lubricative property.
Actually, this reminds me of there is some stories around that Kekulé's discovery was he was dreaming one night and he thought of a snake biting its tail or something like that. Did you have a dream like this or something?
No, not quite. Let me first say something about this discovery. What we did, I mean, Bob Curl and Rick Smalley, the two senior scientists, myself and Jim Heath, Sean O'Brien and Yuan Gu, with students who were working on that project, we accidentally discovered that there was something special about an aggregate of 60 carbon atoms. What was it? And the ideas that started to gel were that possibly a cage had been made. But it was probably a graphitic cage and just a hexagon. Then we thought of Buckminster Fuller's domes and also a star dome that I'd made, and we brought this together, and then Rick started playing with...
You mean Curl?
Rick Smalley started playing with one night, cutting out hexagons. And I said, well, you know, this structure doesn't have only hexagons, it has pentagons as well. And then he remembered about the pentagons and started to cut those out, and then it curved into a sphere, and it worked very nicely, and it turned out that it was the soccer ball. Incidentally, the story about Kekulé is now coming under some careful scrutiny.
Oh. Because I had it in my first chemistry class.
Yeah, but it turns out that Lushmet, the famous yes. Lushmet, who was mm-hmm. a physics and thermodynamics, had actually published the ring structure of benzene 4 years beforehand in a book, which Kekulé apparently had seen. So this icon of discovery is a bit suspect and needs to be looked at more carefully. But it's no doubt that the ring structure was published 4 years before Kekulé. And that story was related by Kekulé 25 years after his presentation. So this is a bit suspect and should not be taken historically, as it is almost always, as an example of how a solution to a scientific problem is actually comes about.
Can you say something about now about what people usually are very interested in, which is knowing what is the applied impact of what do you view any applied impact of this?
Or? Well, I'm not the best person for that because I'm a fundamental scientist. I like to just see how things work. I mean, it's like going down the road like an explorer. You say there's something interesting here, but they don't have a goal. I mean, maybe Columbus had a goal to go around, you know, right. to go around and find India or whatever by going around the world, and then he discovered the serendipity was the USA. One wonders, should he have bothered? I don't know. But anyway, the discovery of America is a fundamental discovery for goal-oriented study, so it's serendipitous. But there are a number of interesting aspects of C60, and one is that it has curious energetic properties. It can store energy a lot longer than other molecules. And one of the possibilities is that it will be a component in the next generation of computers when we think of molecular computers. And if we think of molecular computing, we're thinking in chips which are 100 times smaller in one dimension and 1,000,000 times smaller in volume.
Somehow the thing that occurs to one always, one looks at this molecule and thinks maybe I should stick something inside of it.
Yeah, that too. So it is possible to stick atoms on the inside, and that's a holy grail. For instance, with potassium you can make C60 a superconductor. And if you can put an atom on the inside, there are views that this, some of these atoms can make the C60 solid a high temperature superconducting phase. That's one thing that is looking very interesting. The other thing, of course, is that you can trap, say, a radioactive element which is toxic on the inside, and then put groups on the outside which will target a particular part of the body. So you can then say, okay, put the atom on the inside where it's just captured, it's not bound, and can't get out. So its toxic properties are going there, and then it can go to the point and then decay and just hit that particular site. So that's another exciting possibility.
As you know, something that really amazed me about you always is your special rapport that you have with children. As you know, my two kids have come to your lecture, and both of them had the reaction that this is a cool dude. So, what can you tell us? How come you have this special rapport? You seem to be involved in a variety of programs with children. You seem to enjoy this also a lot. It's not like you're doing it for obligation.
Well, I don't know. One seems to have a better rapport with other people's kids than one's own. I discovered this difficulty. Well, young kids are incredible.
Do you have children of your own?
Yes, of course. They're now 30 years old.
Oh,
so, so they're no longer kids. The kids of about 8 or 9 or 10 are wonderful. Kids of about 18 and 19 are great too, but in the middle they have some problems, and when they're 14 and 12, which is a bit unfortunate. But I like the younger kids because they'll ask questions, they were not inhibited, and they don't have any respect for you, your name or who you are. You've got to perform on time. And they can ask crazy questions, and I think just to see them fascinated by things which don't... But they're not fascinated by things that have applications. They just have this intrinsic interest in structures like this, and they can just make them for their own benefit.
So why is it that these very same children, and this is something that one actually occurs to me right now, why is it that these very same children that have these fascinations, when they become older and they become our leaders, or as you said in your lecture, our politicians, how can they lose this fascination? What's going on here?
Well, I think the politicians I have a problem with, because they've had to go through a period of losing their real ethics and to get to those positions. I mean, I won't say it strongly, but I think there is a problem of getting to positions of power, and I don't think any real scientist would really become a politician, because the problems there are too complicated. I must sort of be careful about what I say. Scientists have to be involved in these socio-economic problems, but if you say you want to solve socio-political, socio-economic problems, these are so multivariable that if you took a problem in the natural world, in the scientific problem, you wouldn't really tackle it, because you would never know whether you were right or wrong.
No, I'm more curious about the fact that, you know, politicians sort of... The children are very curious, they're interested, you show them a thing like this, they start building, then you get to a politician and they blank out completely on you, it seems like, or something. Is there anything that we are doing wrong about our education of the public, or do you have any opinions about this?
Almost certainly, that's true. I mean, one thing is certainly true, is that we don't know how to retain that curiosity. I mean, kids are inherently curious. They'll do anything, they'll play, and play is always the thing. The problem is that to carry on playing, when we put them through the stress of having to take exams and things like this, that's a major problem. Now they don't do these things because they're curious. They do them because they have to get a job, and so one changes the perspective they have. I don't think we know how to educate our kids. I'm absolutely sure about that. I was put under this tremendous pressure, but you put another kid under that pressure and they will wilt. I mean, one thing I have is a resilience. I mean, I don't claim to be necessarily a great scientist, although it appears so because I've got this accolade. I feel I'm a very, very good scientist, but there's some fantastic, wonderful, amazing people that I've met. But I do have a resilience, and I do have something which I don't know where it comes from. I think it comes from something, prayer and pressure, that I never put in a bad job. It'll be as good as I can do, and it may not be as good as someone else can do, but it's the best I can do. Otherwise, I probably won't tackle it, and so I don't give in very easily. And I think that's important, and that's something that is needed in science. And many kids who are curious, when they don't have that, they're great and they're clever, and you know many scientists, but they don't have that determination to continue. And I think it's again, this film, determination is very important to succeed.
But let me ask you this. It seems like the discovery, I don't exactly remember the year, but it was somewhat of a long time ago.
1985,
and now we're in 1997. It's been a long time ago that the discovery of carbon-60, and pretty much everybody agreed that this was carbon-60, I presume, very early on.
Not really. No, well, I think the first year, there were several significant papers saying that the experiment wasn't right.
But eventually, like very soon afterwards, it was...
No, I think it took 2 or 3 years.
2 or 3 years, right.
I think 2 or 3 years. And then 1990, when Kretschmer and Huffman, in fantastic piece of work, who I feel should also have shared in our accolade. I think it's a wonderful piece of work.
They can't, because they're not English. They couldn't have been knighted, I guess.
Well, but I think they could have shared the Nobel Prize.
I see.
That's right. I mean, the knighthood is an interesting thing, but I feel a little bit peculiar about that. I feel peculiar about the prize as well, because it's a funny prize. But when their extraction was published, then everybody knew it was absolutely right. But in fact, there were a lot of question marks hanging over it all the period. I was convinced within about 6 or 7 months, because I'd found another argument, with sort of theoretical argument. Then Rick Smalley's group had actually done some very interesting further work, which had looked pretty good. But then it's 1990, and then there was a period of where lots of interest was shown, and it was shown to be fascinating material, but it still hasn't got a real application in that sense. But it has a very exciting possibilities. But then so had liquid crystals. I mean, liquid crystals took 100 years before we got what we have in my watch. I mean, it took, not only did you have to understand how liquid crystals operated on a microscopic scale and molecular level, but you had to have batteries and semiconductors and these sorts of materials until you could use it as a display device, and 50 to 100 years of understanding of molecular dynamics. And I think C60 is in that same mold. It's so different from anything we've had before. We have to know what it will do before we will find an application.
What's very amazing about this discovery of yours is that you actually were not looking for it. I presume you were looking for something in the stars.
Yeah.
How is this? How does one make the leap from going from I guess a red giant that you were working on, and spectroscopy, finally now doing things in the lab, and
it's the way, like, going, it's going down the road. I mean, you know, it's really a voyage of discovery, and it's really an exploration, because the work that I was doing in the 70s was on carbon chains with my colleague David Walton at Sussex.
Does this relate somehow to Professor Burbidge's at the UCSD?
Probably so loosely. I'm not sure. Obviously there's some involvement with carbon, but carbon's a fascinating material, not only on a chemical level. I mean, the whole of biochemistry is carbon, mm-hmm. and the whole of our organic chemistry is carbon. And the reason that carbon is in the universe at all.
How does one jump from there? One looks at the stars, and suddenly one starts making things and starts playing with soccer.
It's not very difficult. I mean, the experiment was set up with Rick Smalley through Bob Curl originally, because I was interested in the material that was blown out of a carbon star. I mean, we're all formed from carbon that originally was formed in a carbon star. That star blew up, and the carbon then was distributed into space. And I had the thought that maybe this carbon was in the form of chains, and I wanted to show that. And Rick had developed a fantastic apparatus which would form carbon clusters, and I thought these clusters wouldn't be sucked together. I thought they might be carbon chains. When we did the experiment, we found, first the good news, yes, they were carbon chains. Now the bad news, there was something else, and that was C60, which was actually a round cage. and that was unusual. And we saw a signal which was a serendipity, it was totally unexpected, that not only were there these carbon chain molecules, so the idea that carbon star chemistry was interesting, so that was a good step. Mm-hmm. But then there was something else which we then diverted along this track to try and explain why 60 was special. And the reason it's special is the same reason that a soccer ball is special. This is about the most symmetric structure you can make out of little patches.
That's very interesting.
And we kick this around, it's a pretty strong structure, and you can kick around carbon atoms and they have this same very, very beautiful structure.
Now, before this, you were working as a in other chemistry. Can you tell us a little bit about what was your other work in chemistry? Well, I presume that this was not your main work in...
No, my main work was in phosphorus chemistry. I've always had involvement with carbon. And I'm most proud of the work that we did with a colleague, John Nixon, and at Sussex, and that was to make the first carbon-phosphorus double bond. People didn't think that that sort of molecule could exist. And I was working in chemistry of carbon bonded to second row atoms, and that was very good. I could have died happy with just that. And then with a colleague, David Walter, we did some work with an undergraduate, actually. Mm-hmm. It was a very good undergraduate, Alexander, to make long carbon chain molecules for real fundamental purposes. You know, these long ones were very simple and they vibrate, and I thought, well, a bit like a skipping rope. You know, what can you do? You know, when kids play with a skipping rope, you can do things and they will vibrate.
Is chemistry really like this? I mean, you have these images about balls and
absolutely
and skipping ropes and
structures and Buckminster Fuller Dams. Yeah. I mean, chemistry is, and physics too, but chemistry, we're architects.
Well, you know, physicists always talk about the Schrödinger equation and complicated things, and in fact, can one think in these models?
Yes, absolutely. This is actually, when I see benzene, I see a building almost on this nanoscale. When I see C60, I see a Buckminster Fuller dome. When a chemist sees a formula, he can see this as a tangible object. He doesn't. It's a sort of abstraction. But just as useless when you see a formula or quantum mechanics, you see in that formula wave functions and also the implications as far as things like superconductivity are concerned. Right. We can make that jump. But just like someone else, you say Macbeth, and they see in that, from that one word, they see the plumbing of the depths of human spirit, both good and bad. And Macbeth was a great man and a bad man. He was the greatest good and greatest bad man at the same time, and Shakespeare plumbed that. Just as chemists have plumbed the beauty of this microcosmic world, and physicists of the nuclear particles.
It seems like you believe actually that we can see actual images, that electrons are little balls and...
Well, yes, and I mean, we do see that. I mean, I think we do have those images, and some scientists will certainly see that in the mathematics, but there will be some, I think, pattern, an image, and there's always a pattern behind everything, even if it's only a pattern of the way the wave function can be drawn, or in the way that the operators will move in matrices. I think there's always a pattern somewhere. May not be a spatial pattern.
So your main work actually that led to all this was in stellar evolution. So if I would be a real interviewer in a commercial TV, I would ask you, so what is the point of working on stellar evolution? What would you say to that?
Well, I wouldn't go as far as stellar evolution. I would say that one of the interesting aspects of this is that we've discovered the form in which carbon in a star comes out of that star and forms a direct path from the star to the biosphere. So we now know, and carbon, as we say, is necessary for life. So we really understand a bit more about life at the earliest stages than we did before.
I would like to actually ask you something about your personal... personal question, if I may. We have known each other for a number of years and we are colleagues, and now you have been put into this our stars.
Yes.
You are one of our stars. How has this changed your life? Has it?
Not all for the good, but it's completely changed. I mean, in a way that's only now becoming clear, because one becomes public property and people outside science think you're, you know, have a high, very high IQ, and that you must be a genius. And when, you know, you don't need to be a genius to do this. You have to be a good scientist, and you have to really follow things up. And this teamwork is involved in this, and then be very lucky.
What do you mean, be a good scientist? You said that several times before.
I think you have to be to get above a certain level and continue to do science, and not, just for its own sake. I mean, to do things that just interest you and be your own person. I mean, don't take any notice of other people. If they think it's not worth doing, just still do it, because in fact the discovery of C60 was out of a problem that I was particularly interested in, rather mundane. I mean, I wasn't desperate to do this experiment. I walked into Rick's lab and said, this apparatus can do this experiment. I mean, this was brilliant, a piece of apparatus. Which had, was for the first time could produce little bits of refractory materials, you know, 20 iron atoms stuck together. And I thought, well, maybe this can simulate the conditions in a carbon star. And not many, in fact, nobody else was interested in that. And it was a mundane thing. Well, I can do it now. I didn't even think about doing it. But I saw this experiment, this technique, I thought we could do it. And then we were able to do it. But it's changed my life in the sense that now people outside chemistry and physics and science think that you're important. And that's not necessarily, that's good and bad about it, because one feels like a spokesperson for the chemistry and physics community and the science community. And that's a rather large burden. And I feel like in Britain I have to do this, because, you know, we haven't had a Nobel Prize for a long time, whereas you had five last year. I was one of six people, and three physicists and three chemists were five. So you got a lot of them. A lot of them are expats, of course, and think of first and second generation expats. As am I from my parents from Berlin. But I do feel a pressure on that, and I feel I have to do it.
Well,
it's changed my life that way.
We're out of time. I hope you enjoyed this edition of UCSD Guestbook, where my guest today was Harry Kroto, 1996 winner of the Chemistry Nobel Prize for the discovery of Buckminster Fullerin. Harry, thank you very much. It was a real pleasure to have you, and thank you for joining us today. Thank you.